sign-up sheet out in the foyer. Let's take a look at it and make sure it's filled out. There will be a youth outing Saturday night at our house. We're looking forward to seeing everybody. Now we'll turn the song service over to Jerry.
Crowd is a little light this evening. Let's all get a, just join in the singing, and we can glorify God with our singing.
Father, we love you, we worship and adore you. Glorify your name in all the earth. Glorify your name. Glorify your name.
For the first prayer, three verses are from Every Stormy Wind.
There is a
Let us pray. Dear God in heaven, we thank you for another afternoon of worship. We pray, Lord, that you'll guide us through this worship. May all the things that we say and do be pleasing unto you. We first beg forgiveness of our sin, whatever we've said, done, or left undone, God, that would separate us from you. We pray you forgive us that you might hear this prayer this evening, Lord. We thank you, dear Lord, for the great and wonderful blessing you've given us in Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that you loved us so much that you would send him to this earth to be our salvation. And thank you, Lord Jesus, for loving God, loving us, and being completely obedient, that you would leave heaven, all its splendor and glory, knowing full well what was before you. But you loved us so much that you came and fulfilled God's mission. And we thank you. We pray, Lord, that you give us strength to study your word each day, to show ourselves better approved to you. Help us to keep uppermost in our mind the two most important commandments that you gave us, to love God and to love each other. We pray, Lord, that you give us the spirit, the strength, and the desire to fulfill those commands. We pray for our brothers and sisters who are sick, Lord, those who are having problems, and we pray that you would heal them, that they could be back here to worship with us. We pray especially for Linda and her surgery, that you would help her to be well soon. We pray for any of the others who have had surgeries, Lord, and we pray that you bless them and may they all heal quickly. We pray, Lord, that you have mercy on this country. We dare not beg you or plead with you to change your will. As we study and know in the Old Testament, when you have made up your mind to punish the evil ones, you do it. We just pray, Lord, that you would have mercy on our nation. Save a remnant of the Christians who love you, who love the Constitution that you gave us, who love a civil and decent way of life, that we might share love with each other. We pray, Lord, that you would have mercy on this nation. Help us when you're through with whatever it is you're about to do, that you will save a remnant to replace this nation, to redo it just as you did the Jewish and the Jews in the Old Testament. We pray, God, a special prayer of thanksgiving for those of us here who are older and have lived such a wonderful life in this place. We pray that you would save it for those children who come after us. Please give us strength too to defeat the evil that we can and to spread the love that we can, to spread the gospel and bring more people to you. Again, we pray for forgiveness of our sin. Again, we say thank you, Lord Jesus, for your sacrifice. We pray this prayer in your most holy name. Amen.
It's good to have each one back this evening for our services. I hope that some of our sick are feeling a bit better. I think our way, some of them are. So that's good news there. But let's continue to pray for all those that are sick, not doing well, that they'll soon be better. But again, it's good to be here tonight. Have you ever seen a scar on someone and you wanted to ask them about it? Or maybe you have one and someone asks you about it? You know, I'm not going to put a graphic up there of any scars or anything, so don't worry about that. But you may have a scar from a surgery and you say, let me tell you about that. I don't have any obvious scars along that line, but on my fingernails, since you ask, they're instead of being rounded across the top that they're supposed to, most of them right around here are flat on top. And since you want to know, you know, why they were flat on top, back when I was in high school and college, I worked at a shoe repair shop, and when you're sanding the shoes like you had to do on these wheel sanders that were going real fast, heavy grit, if you slipped, your thumb would go up against it or your fingernail would go up against it, and it'd grind it down to the meat. And it'd grow back, do it again, it'd grow back, and over the years, as it grew back flat. And so now every time I kind of feel that, I go back to shoe repair shop days. I mean, it reminds me of the shoe repair shop. And every time I use a grinder, I'm reminded I need to be a little bit more careful than I was back when I was a teenager, you know, working or in my early 20s working in a shoe repair shop. And so I try to be a little bit more careful in particular because I don't want to go all the way down to the quick again. You know, but every scar tells a story. Some can be something simple as your hand slipping. I could tell you about, you know, a scar I have from touching a hot muffler on a chainsaw. You might see a pattern forming here with me and certain things that happen. But you know, sometimes things are just because you're a little careless at times, you don't pay attention, or you get scared and grab for something. Other times it might be where you're trying to do something good. I heard a story the other day, there was an accident somewhere below Montgomery where a man stopped to help and pull some people out of a fiery vehicle and save some lives, I believe, but he was in the hospital, I think in an induced coma, the last I'd heard, because of the burns on his body. You know, he will have scars on his body to remind him of the good deed that he did. You know, every scar tells a story. And so, you know, we don't mind sharing ours or hearing others sometimes. Maybe there's some we'd like to think about, others we don't want to think about as well. Some good, some bad. But again, they have a story. The Apostle Paul said, look at me. In Galatians 6:17, from now on let no one trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. There were people that troubled the Apostle Paul. And here he was, a man who gave his life totally to Christ. He was a man that was a strong, sound Christian. A man that above that was an apostle of Jesus Christ. He went into some difficult situations, had the Jews after him, the Gentiles after him, even people that are supposed to be Christians that were after him as well. And so people questioned his credentials as to his apostleship. And he gave those credentials and said, look, you know, I'm an apostle by God, by Jesus Christ. It's Christ that chose him to be an apostle, not a man. But then he said, look at the marks on my body. Look at what I have suffered for the cause of Christ. I'm not an imposter. I'm not someone trying to trick Christians or whatever and lead them away. Look at the marks, the scars that are there in my body, and what do they tell you about me? I mean, you look at the Apostle Paul. He was imprisoned. You can imagine back in that day and age with the prisons like they were, what kind of scars he'd have, not just from the shackles, but just from the malnourishment and the mistreatment that you would have in many of those places. Cruel to say the least. They were probably many times pushed around, shoved around, beaten as well. He was stoned on one occasion to the point they thought he was dead, or some will say he was dead and was brought back to life, but at least looked dead after he was stoned. And you can imagine somebody throwing stones at you, big stones, until you die or are at the point of death. What kind of physical and mental and emotional scars that would leave. He was shipwrecked. I mean, floating in the sea for a while, then you know, you go up on an island, not to mention the snake bite he received as a result of that as well, next to the fire. All the different journeys that he took, the missionary journeys, you know, from one place to the next, going through very treacherous territory, it takes a toll on your body. You know, sometimes you can be busy doing fun things, good things, but after a while you say, I'm getting tired. And Paul was doing good things for the cause of Christ. But there were some difficult situations. But even then, even when it was not the most difficult of situations, he was busy, busy, busy. And that puts wear and tear on your body, to say the least. He was beaten on many occasions, unjustly. and without mercy in most occasions. Just weary from everything that took place in life. Not just weary from the journeying, but can you imagine how he had to put up with Christians fighting with one another and trying to discuss that? Here you are wanting to save souls, and you have brothers and sisters in Christ that are arguing with one another and can't get along. Here you have brothers in Christ that are trying to destroy you when you're trying to simply win others to Christ. And then you just get tired of the constant negativity or opposition or whatever it may be. But Paul kept on keeping on. He said he hungered, he thirsted. I mean, he had the same needs that we have, you know, as we have. At times he had plenty, but many times he had to do without. And on it could go. You think about all the Apostle Paul went through, and I'm sure it left us mark. Now, Paul talked about his thorn in the flesh, and the Scriptures really doesn't tell us what his thorn in the flesh is. We could argue about that and whether it was something that you could notice and see on him or not, but whatever that may be, you could add that to the list as well of something that he had to deal with, of a scar, if you will. Whether you're talking about a figurative scar or a literal scar, a scar that he had to deal with. The Apostle Paul said, look at the marks that I have here on my body. You could see the physical marks. You could tell the emotional and spiritual and mental marks that were there as well. There are times that he would pray and cry on behalf of people, plead with tears. We mentioned in the Bible class in the auditorium this morning in the book of Ephesians, that when he left talking to the Ephesian elders, you know, they hugged each other, they kissed each other, they cried together because he knew that he would not see them again. And it wasn't just those that he cared about, it was others as well. But Paul just said, look, you know, I have those marks. They're there. And just as surely as Paul had those marks, you could look at your life and say, well, I have those marks too. You know, you can go back at your experience, and some of them may be physical scars that you have from maybe an accident that you've had or a surgery that you've had. Others could be, maybe you were doing something good and helped someone and it cost you. Or just being a little clumsy at times. And, you know, but we all have those marks in there. But let's think in more of a figurative sense. When we look at the scars that we have spiritually in our lives, what about those scars? Scars are there to remind us. You know, whatever the scar may be. I can remember my shoe shop days. I can remember the time I tried to catch a chainsaw I dropped and grabbed the muffler and burned my hand. And I have learned a little bit since then, I think, to be a little bit more careful, I hope. But or I won't be around much longer. But anyway, but whatever those scars may be, they remind us. The physical scars remind us. But when you have an emotional scar, a spiritual scar, there's reminders there. As we see it in our life or in the lives of others, scars remind us that sin is painful. It's painful when you get burnt and it leaves a scar. It's painful when you cut yourself to the point that maybe you have to have stitches and it leaves a scar. It's painful when you have to have a serious surgery to save your life. It leaves a scar. Sin leaves a scar. You know, a scar. You know, sin is painful. Proverbs 13:15, good understanding gains favor, but the way of the unfaithful is hard. I think it's the King James says the way of the transgressor is hard. And that's the way I have normally said it. The way of the transgressor, the way of the unfaithful, the way of the one that goes against God's will. In other words, the way of the sinner is hard. It says if you choose to live a sinful life, if you choose to sin, you may think it's easy. You may think it's the best way, the easy way to get by, but it says it's hard because there's consequences to those sins. I mean, there can be immediate consequences. You know, the person that drinks and drives, that can cause problems. And there may be immediate consequences as well with a person who goes out and commits adultery and winds up losing their spouse as a result of it. You know, we can look at all sorts of things that can be immediately. It may not be that type of sin. It can be something else as well. But sin is painful. We look at the pleasures of sin, sure. It says, but they're for a season. But there's pain. Pain for us, maybe pain for someone else as well. Psalm 38 and verse 18 says, I will declare my iniquity. I will be in anguish over my sin. You ever had a guilty conscience? How does that make you feel when you feel guilty about something? I've mentioned before, I remember when I was little, I had a dream that I don't know what I'd done as a 10-year-old, but I dreamed I was standing before Jesus on Judgment Day, and I couldn't really see Jesus. I could just hear his voice booming down, and he said, "You did not make it." And I woke up screaming. So I don't know what I did, but I straightened up whatever I did at that point. Just a young boy with a guilty conscience about whatever I had or had not done. But I know I made it right after that, whatever it was. But you know, there's that anguish over sin, the guilt that's there as well. It says, don't think it's worth it to live a sinful life. I mean, the world's going to play it up as something good, but it causes pain. It leaves its mark. It may affect your life. It will affect your life, and it may affect the life of those around you as well. You can hurt not only yourself, but others. You know, you look at David, and we studied David on the Tuesday class, and he sinned with Bathsheba. And when he confessed that sin to God, he said, "God, against you only have I sinned." And he didn't mean, "I haven't hurt anyone else." But as far as accountability was concerned, as king, the only person he was accountable to was God. But he had sinned against some other people as well. He had sinned against Bathsheba, took advantage of her when he should not have. He had sinned against Uriah by having him killed. He sinned against those that he told to go and have Uriah killed as well, getting them involved in it. I mean, you can begin to add up the different ones that are involved, and I mean, he affected a number of lives in that regard. Sin is painful for yourself and for others as well. Scars remind us as well, not only the pain of sin, you think back of the pain when you got those scars, but also you don't want to make that same mistake twice. Hopefully we learn from it. Hopefully I've learned to handle a grinder better or a chainsaw better along the way. Hopefully whatever we've done that's caused problems, you say, "Well, next time I'm going to be more careful." If it's because of something we shouldn't have done that we've done, or some accident that we had, you say, "I'm going to be a little bit more careful next time," because we don't want to do it twice. I mean, you touch a hot stove one time, and I'm smart enough after when I was little to touch it one time and realize I don't need to touch that hot stove again. It doesn't work out too well. And so you learn from that, or maybe you can learn from the mistakes of others, the scars of others. You can look at people who have done some terrible things in their life or made some mistakes that you've been tempted to do as well, and then you look at the results in their life. You see the trouble it caused them, the difficulties they have. You see the scars that are there in their life and the lives of the ones around them. You say, "Ooh, if that worked out like that for them, I sure don't want to do that myself." And we can learn from that. In 1 Corinthians 10, verses 6 through 11, he said, "Here's some things that happen as our examples, to the intent that we should not lust after evil things they also lusted." And he goes on and says, you look back at the things that were written back in the Old Testament, there's a purpose to it. It shows God's plan unfolding. It shows God at work, and but also there's some examples given to us of God's relationship to us and our relationship to God, and the consequences of doing evil. Brother Billy in the prayer talked about God, you know, lifting up nations or bringing them down, and indeed he can and does. But you say, you look at those that became idolaters, look what happened to them. Look at the sexual immorality they committed, and look what happened. They tempted Christ. It says they complained. I mean, you might say, "Wait a minute, that's kind of interesting to put complaining in there right in the middle of all that." But, you know, when you complain, you're not really trusting God like you should. When you're complaining to God about God's commands, about what God said to do, what God's doing for you, then you're questioning God and his authority, God and his ability, God and his wisdom. And they complain. He said, look, these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition upon whom the ends of the age have come. He said, here's some examples given to you. You look at the scars in their life, or you look at the mark that it left in them. Some of them were wiped out and destroyed. Others of them had to, you know, they had to wander in the wilderness till they died. You look at those that were struck down. You look as well at different ones who did things that they should not do, and just the turmoil it caused in their life and the lives of those around them as well. And you can look in the world around us today. We can look within our families and see the same thing play out. We can learn from others not to make the same mistakes they did. But if you have to learn the hard way, and you do it yourself, hopefully you learn from the mistake and don't keep on sinning, hoping you'll get it right the next time. Or you make the same mistake, hoping next time it's going to work out a little bit better. Don't do that. It doesn't work that way. God's way is the right way. God, you know, Jesus said, "Come to me. You know, my burden's easy. You know, my yoke is easy. My burden's light." And so, you know, that's the proper way. But don't do it the way of the world. It seems like it's going to be an easy way, but it can bear you down. Sin is painful. We're reminded that we don't want to make that same mistake twice. Also, we need to understand healing doesn't always remove the scar. And sometimes you can heal up and you say, well, I don't even see a scar there anymore. And I was preparing this lesson, I got to looking, because I had a certain scar, I remembered, and I go, well, I guess all the wrinkles have kind of covered up the scar after a while, so I guess there's some positive to that as well. But, you know, sometimes the scars can kind of go away, but many times they do not. In Galatians 6, verse 7, do not be deceived. God does not mock. Whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. I mean, there's consequences sometimes. Even if we have been forgiven, the seed that we have sown, sometimes there's a harvest we reap this side of eternity. We may still have a home with God in heaven, but, you know, here's a person that's robbed a bank. He asks for forgiveness from God because he realizes, right, you know, turns himself in, gives the money back or whatever, but then he still has to go to prison for armed robbery or whatever, you know, bank robbery, and yet he's been forgiven. I mean, we understand, and it may not be on that scale like a legal thing, but it can be whatever it may be. You know, there's still consequences that are there. Also, you look at a person, I remember back years ago when I was a youth minister, we had a youth speaker come in, and the fellow was talking about drug abuse. And he said, look, I can tell you about drug abuse, because he had been a terrible, terrible drug addict. Just anything you could imagine, something that you could not imagine he had been involved in his life. And he just, only by the grace of God, he said, was he able to still be alive. And he finally hit bottom and went further, I think, and then he straightened his life out. And I don't know if he... I can't remember now if he was a Christian at Aird or not, but anyway, he was right with the Lord. He was I knew by the time he was speaking to us, he was a faithful Christian and trying to do right, live right. But he said, you know, I don't really know how much longer I have because of the wear and tear it's placed on my body. I mean, he said, I may live many more years, but probably not. Well, we had such a good response to him speaking. Later, we wanted to get him to come back for something else a couple of years later, and I called, and I said, I need to speak to so-and-so. And they said, why do you need to talk to him about it? And I said, to speak. They said, we're having his funeral this afternoon. He had passed away. And I mean, and it was because he had put such wear and tear on his body. At least he died as a faithful Christian. That's a wonderful thing. But the sad part was, you know, he had forgiveness. He had healed, as it were. But there were those scars, literal physical scars there, that had taken a toll on his body. And it may not be the physical, it can be spiritual, it can be emotional, but there's marks that are left. There's fences that have to be mended, there's attitudes that may have to be adjusted or whatever. You may have to prove yourself to others once again, or whatever it may be. But understand, there still may be a scar there. There still may be some issues to deal with along the way. In Proverbs 13:15, again it says, the way of the unfaithful is hard. The way of the transgressor is hard. It can be difficult. Sin is painful. We're reminded that we don't want to make the same mistake twice. We're reminded that those scars, that the scar may be there, you know, as a reminder to us of what has happened in the past. But also, past failures don't make us useless. Just because I have a scar, because I messed up somewhere, doesn't mean I can't do that the right way the next time. Just because I failed in the past, you know, I have those spiritual scars, as it were, just because I have those failures doesn't make me useless. I mean, you look at the Apostle Peter. He was one who the Lord said, you're going to deny me three times for the rooster crows. I won't do it. No, I won't do it. I'll be there for you. In fact, he cut off Malchus's ear to show that he was willing to fight to the death. But when Jesus put that ear back on, he didn't understand what was going on, just like the others didn't. And when people began to question him as Jesus was on trial, he denied the Lord, denied him again, and denied him with cursing and swearing the final time just to prove to him, I'm not a follower of his. The lowest low, he goes out, he's weeping bitterly. But then Jesus accepts him back. And he comes back, I think, bigger and stronger and better than he ever was, because he had been forgiven. He preached the first gospel sermon. I mean, here's a fellow that denied the Lord. You might say, well, hey, you was going to get to preach the first gospel sermon, we're going to hand it over to John now. I mean, he was there at the foot of the cross. Where were you? But no, Jesus could see in Peter what his heart was like. He knew what his life was like. Peter made some big mistakes. You know, Judas did what he did and went out and hung himself. Peter could have given up, gone back home, gone back to fishing. But instead, he made his life right, and he was still useful in a great way. The Apostle Paul, when he was Saul of Tarsus, He was killing Christians, leading them off to prison, to death. He was doing what he could to destroy the church, to get people to blaspheme. And then when he met the Lord on the road to Damascus, what do you think he thought at that point when the Lord confronted him? Probably thought he was about to be struck dead and sent off to eternal damnation, but instead he was told, you go in the city. You know, I have a special purpose for you in the city. You'll be told what you must do. And he's told. His eyesight's restored. He's praying. He's fasting. He's penitent. His eyesight's restored. He's told to arise and be baptized, wash away his sins, calling on the name of the Lord, and he does that. He's made an apostle by the Lord himself. And he goes immediately and begins to preach the gospel. He goes to the Jews first, but then he goes to the Gentiles as well and has some wonderful missionary journeys. You look at the difference in Paul. Paul could have looked at himself. He said, I'm the chief of sinners. And he goes, look, I'm the chief of sinners. There's no way I can be used for the kingdom's sake. Maybe God can scrape by and save me some way, but surely I can't be at the forefront. The Paul said, look, I'm the chief of sinners. But he was thankful for the grace of God. And he didn't want God's grace to be in vain. He didn't want Jesus' death on the cross to be in vain. And so he did everything he could. He remembered. The scars were there in his mind. He remembered the things that he had done. But he realized as well that he had been forgiven and that he wasn't useless. He could turn that around and use it for serving God. And he considered himself thankful that he was worthy to suffer for the cause of Christ. You look at John Mark, and that's one that Paul sent back home. He went back home on his missionary journey. And then when they wanted to go back again, Barnabas wanted to take John Mark. Paul did not. And Paul could have gotten mad and just had a temper at that point and said, I want nothing else to do with John Mark ever again. John Mark could have said, I don't want anything else to do with Paul again or even with the gospel or whatever else. But later in life, Paul asked for John Mark to come because he's useful for him. And that shows you Paul's attitude. It shows you John Mark's attitude. It shows you maybe some maturing on John Mark's life, depending on how you interpret why he went back home and what happened there. But whatever the case may be, they mended fences. They didn't let those past issues keep them from being what they should be and doing what they should do. What about us? As you look at your scars, and again, it can be physical, emotional, spiritual. As you look at your scars, what do they remind you of? Do they remind you of that sin is painful? I'm not going to make that mistake again. You know, I know it's going to be there with me, but I can still make it. Do we realize that we're not useless? You know, every scar has a story. Not every scar is due to foolishness. Not every scar is due to recklessness or regret. Some scars are due to love. You know, you look at Paul's scars. Why did he have those scars? Because he loved the Lord. Why did he have the scars that he had? It's because he loved his fellow man. He wanted his fellow Jews to be saved. He wanted the Gentiles to be saved. He wanted everyone to hear the gospel of Christ. Those Roman soldiers that held him prisoner, the Roman emperor who was so wicked, he wanted them to be saved as well. He had his scars because of love. You think about the scars of Jesus, the scars on his hand, the scars on his feet, the scars on his head from the crown of thorns, the scars on his back from being scourged unmercifully. Those scars were on him because of his love for you and me. Jesus loved us so much that he suffered all that he did so that we could be saved. What about us? Can we count ourselves joyful and thankful that we can suffer for the cause of Christ? You know, I hope we don't have to suffer a lot for the cause of Christ, but if we do, are we willing to? First of all, it depends on us serving the Lord like we should. You know, as it says on the chart, I hope our love for Christ with Jesus will grow when we consider his scars. May we live in such a way that we can share in his scars for the kingdom's sake. Will you share with Jesus in living, even suffering for the cause of Christ? First of all, will you give your life to Jesus tonight by becoming a Christian? If you need to respond to his invitation tonight, if you need to put your Lord on in baptism, if you need to repent of sin in your life and ask for prayer, whatever need you may have, won't you come while together we stand and while we sing?
To be peace. If you'd like to partake of the Lord's Supper this evening, would you please raise your hand?
After the singing of this verse of this song, we will be led in our closing prayer.
We've got three that we need to add to our list this evening. It